Hello students, I'm Ms. Deepika Bhandari. Today I bring you the next learning episode in BSc Forensic Science on an important unit of the paper titled Technological Methods in Forensic Science, that is X-ray spectrometry. Dear students, in this lecture we will be introducing you to another instrumental technique known as X-ray spectrometry, its theory and instrumentation. You will also get to know about non-dispersive X-ray absorption method, X-ray diffraction and their application. In addition to it, you will also be studying about fluorescence method and its applications. We will wind up this lecture with a discussion on crystal tonography and conclusion. So dear students, let us have a look at the modules which we will be learning today. Module 1. Introduction to X-ray spectrometry. Module 2, general theory. Module 3, instrumentation. Module 4, non-dispersive X-ray absorption method. Module 5, application of X-ray absorption method. Module 6, X-ray diffraction. Module 7, application of X-ray diffraction. Module 8, fluorescence methods. Module 9, applications of fluorescence methods. Module 10, crystal tonography, and module 11, conclusion. A range of X-ray techniques and methods are in use, but we shall categorize all methods into three main categories. These are X-ray absorption, X-ray diffraction methods, and X-ray fluorescence. First, X-ray absorption methods. These are analogous to absorption methods in the other regions of electromagnetic spectrum. Quantity of X-ray photons absorbed is considered to be a measure of the concentration of the absorbing substance. X-ray absorption methods are useful in certain cases like elemental analysis and thickness measurements. As compared with other X-ray methods, absorption methods are the least used. B. X-ray diffraction methods. Diffraction methods are based on the dispersion of X-rays by crystals. By means of these methods, we can identify the crystal structures of numerous solid compounds. These methods are extremely important as compared to X-ray absorption and X-ray fluorescence methods. C. X-ray fluorescence methods. In this method, X-rays is produced by the fluorescent sample. By measuring the wavelength and intensity of the produced X-rays, qualitative and quantitative analysis can be performed. X-ray fluorescence method is a non-destructive method. Moreover, it requires very little sample preparation before the analysis is to be carried out. Each of the mentioned method is applied to different fields of analysis and depends upon different characteristics of the radiation. For example, X-ray absorption is employed to analyze imperfections in the inner structure of the material through which it passes. X-ray diffraction is applied to establish crystalline structure. X-ray fluorescence is utilized for quantitative and qualitative elemental analysis. All these three techniques are non-destructive. First, the origin of X-rays. The X-ray region of the electromagnetic spectrum consists of wavelengths in the region of about 0.1 to 100 angstrom. For analytical purposes, the range of 0.7 to 2 angstrom is the most valuable region. X-rays are produced when high-velocity electrons strike a metal target. The process of producing X-rays may be visualized in terms of Bohr's theory of atomic structure. An atom is made up of a nucleus and numerous electrons. The electrons are arranged in layers or shells with the valence electrons in the outer shell. The different shells or layers of electrons are called the K shell, L shell, M shell, and so on. Whenever a rapid moving electron impinges an atom, it may knock out an electron completely from one of the inner shells of that atom. Following the loss of inner shell electron, one of the outer electrons will fall into the vacant orbital with the instantaneous emission of an X-ray photon. The energy of the emitted X-ray photon is equivalent to the difference in energy between the two levels involved. The X-ray spectrum of a copper target consists of a few sharp and intense lines superimposed on a polychromatic background called white radiation. These sharp lines are due to emitted X-ray photon, whose wavelength is equivalent to the difference in energy between the two levels involved and are characteristic of that material. Interaction of X-ray with matter. The X-rays can interact with matter in three ways: absorption, diffraction, and fluorescence. First, we shall discuss about absorption. If a beam of X-rays is permitted to penetrate through matter, it loses energy partly by scattering and some due to absorption. The absorption of X-rays means that the electrons of the atoms comprising the matter absorb energy from these X-rays and get excited. Then these excited electrons emit secondary X-rays characteristic of those atoms. Second is diffraction. This shall be discussed in following sections. Third is fluorescence. If a sample is irradiated with an X-ray beam and it irradiates X-ray beams of different wavelength, the method is termed as X-ray fluorescence. The wavelength of the X-ray fluorescence enables us to establish the identity of the element. The intensity of the emitted X-rays forms the basis of quantitative analysis. This method of elemental analysis is independent of the molecular structure of the element. The method is non-destructive in nature and requires very less or little sample preparation. X-ray absorption, X-ray diffraction, and X-ray fluorescence are the three main fields of X-ray spectroscopy. Only the optical system varies in each case, although components of the equipment are the same. The main components are described as follows. First, production of X-ray. X-rays are produced as high-velocity electrons that impinge on a metal object. Almost 1% of the entire energy of the electron beam is transformed into X-ray radiation, the remainder being dissipated as heat. Several types of X-ray tubes are used for producing X-rays. Figure 1 shows schematic diagram of an X-ray source. Second is collimator. The X-rays produced by the object material are randomly directed. They form a hemisphere with the target material at the center. The X-rays produced by the target material are then permitted to pass through a collimator that consists of two sets of closely packed metal plates divided by a small gap. The collimator absorbs all the X-rays except the fine beam that passes between the gaps. Figure 2 shows collimator system for achieving a narrow beam of X-rays. Third component is the monochromator. Monochromatic beams of X-rays can be obtained by two methods. First, by filter. A narrow wavelength range X-ray beam is obtained by inserting a suitable filter in the path of wide range X-rays. A filter is made of a material which absorbs all but desired radiations. A nearly monochromatic beam of radiation is thus available. An interesting example is the zirconium filter, which is employed for molybdenum radiation. Second is crystal monochromator. A crystal monochromator is positioned in the path of X-ray beam so that the angle of the reflecting planes satisfies the Bragg's equation for the required wavelength. The beam is split up by the crystalline material into the component wavelengths in the similar way as a prism splits up the white light into a rainbow. Such a crystalline material is called an analyzing crystal. Fourth component is detectors. The X-ray intensities are calculated and recorded by photographic plate, counter methods, scintillation detector and semiconductor detector. These types of methods depend upon the ability of X-rays to ionize matter and vary only in the subsequent fate of the electrons formed by the ionizing process. First, we shall discuss about photographic methods. To record the position and intensity of X-ray beams, a cylindrical film is used. The film is developed after exposing to X-rays. Second is counter methods. These are of following types: Geiger-Müller tube. The Geiger tube is packed with an inert gas like argon, and the central wire anode is maintained at a positive potential of 800 to 2500 volts. When an X-ray enters the Geiger tube, this impacts the filling gas, causing it to lose an electron. This results in the production of an ion pair, and the electron produced moves towards the central anode while the positive ion moves towards the cylindrical outer electrode. The electron is hastened by the potential gradient and causes the ionization of a large number of argon atoms, resulting in the production of an avalanche of electrons that are traveling in the direction of the central anode. This results in an output pulse of 1 to 10 volts, which can be determined very easily by employing a simple circuit. Figure 3 shows the Geiger-Müller tube. Next is proportional counter. Its construction is analogous to a Geiger tube counter, with lesser potential being maintained between the electrodes. A proportional counter is packed with a heavier gas like xenon or krypton. The heavier gas is chosen because it is easily ionized. Next is scintillation detector. In a scintillation detector, there is a large sodium iodide crystal activated with a small amount of thallium. When X-ray is incident upon the crystal, the pulses of visible light are emitted, which can be detected by a photomultiplier tube. Next is solid-state semiconductor detector. In this detector, the electrons generated by X-ray beam are upheld to conduction bands. The current thus generated is directly proportional to the incident X-ray energy. Next is semiconductor detectors. When an X-ray falls on a semiconductor or a silicon lithium drifted detector, it generates an electron and a hole in a fashion analogous to the formation of an ion pair in a proportional counter. These detectors are of prime importance in both X-ray work and neutron activation analysis. In this apparatus, a tungsten X-ray tube is employed as a source, which operates at 15 to 45 kilowatts. A synchronous motor-driven chopper and an attenuator are placed between source and sample or reference compartments, which alternately interrupts one half of the X-ray beams. There are duplicate reference and sample cells up to 65 centimeters in length. If liquids or gases are to be analyzed, there are special arrangements for continuous flow of process streams. Both halves of X-ray beam are permitted to descend on a common phosphor-coated photomultiplier tube, which is confined from visible light by a thin metallic filter. This method is widely used in analysis of any sample that contains one element markedly heavier than the others. However, some selected applications are as follows. First, it can be used to determine chlorine in hydrogen, plastics and hydrocarbons. Second, it can be used to determine barium fluoride in carbon and barium or lead in glass. Third, for qualitative analysis, This is based upon the simple fact that there is a large difference in the mass absorption coefficient of one element from another. Fourth, for quantitative analysis, amount of X-rays absorbed is directly proportional to the concentration of the element present. This characteristic is widely used to detect broken bones, impurities, segregations, etc. X-ray diffraction is commonly used for investigating the internal structures. Determination of crystal structure by Bragg's law. The X-rays are permitted to fall on the crystal surface. Then the crystal is rotated and X-rays are made to diffract from various lattice planes. The intense reflections are measured by Bragg's X-ray spectrometer, and the glancing angle for each intense reflection is recorded. Rotating crystal method. The rotating crystal method was developed by Schiebold in 1919. Powder crystal method. In the above method, a single crystal is necessary whose size is a lot larger than microscopic dimensions. However, in the powder method, as little as 1 mg of the powder material is sufficient for the study. The powder technique was devised separately by Debye and Scherer in Germany and by Hull in America at about the same time. Elucidation of structure of crystals. The analytical applications of X-ray diffraction are numerous. The method is non-destructive and gives information about the molecular structure of the sample. Perhaps its most vital use is to measure the size of crystal planes. Polymer characterization. Powder method can be used to establish the degree of crystallinity of the polymers. Annealing of metals. The well annealed metals are in ordered crystal form and hence gives sharp diffraction lines. If the metal is subjected to drilling, hammering or bending, it becomes worked or fatigued. That is, its crystal becomes broken and the X-ray pattern becomes more diffused. Particle size determination. A range of X-ray techniques may be used to determine the size of particles or crystallites. Following are the methods for particle size determination. First is spot counting method. Second, broadening of diffraction lines. Third is low angle scattering. Applications of diffraction methods in complexes. A. Determination of cis and trans isomerism. Determination of linkage isomerism. Soil classification based on crystallinity. Analysis of industrial dust. Assess the weathering and degradation of natural and synthetic minerals. Corrosion products of metals can be studied by this method. Tooth enamel and dentine have been examined by X-ray diffraction. Effects of diseases on bone structure and tissue structure, and identification of crystalline compounds. First, the principle. The elements of the sample get excited by absorbing primary X-rays and discharge their own X-rays of characteristic wavelength. This procedure is called X-ray fluorescence. Next, the working. The schematic diagram for an X-ray fluorescence system is shown. The filtered primary X-rays from the tube hit the sample and produce the fluorescence radiation characteristic of the elements in the sample. This radiation passes through a collimator and onto the analyzing crystal. The wavelength is determined and recorded as the synchronized detector rotates in an arc around the analyzing crystal. Figure 4 shows the schematic diagram of an X-ray fluorescence system. X-ray fluorescence Fluorescence is a method of elemental analysis used for qualitative analysis as well as for quantitative analysis. First, this technique is used in agriculture for the determination of trace elements in plants and food, detection of insecticides in fruit and leaves, determination of phosphorus in fertilizers, etc. Second, it is applied for direct determination of sulfur in protein, chloride in blood serum, strontium in blood serum and bone tissue, etc. Third, it is used for the examination of ores, tailings, concentrates and drilled cores, determination of silica in flowing slurries of ores, determination of lead in lead tin alloys, etc. Fourth, other applications includes the determination of additives in motor oil by determining barium, zinc, phosphorus, calcium and chloride and the determination of lead or sulfur in gasoline. Fifth, it is used in rubber industry for the determination of vulcanizing elements. There are numerous experimental diffraction techniques developed in current years, which help in analyzing the microscopical defects in a crystal. Most crystals are far from perfect and exhibit regions or grains with somewhat differing orientations, or they may contain individual defects such as dislocations or faults dispersed throughout the crystal. Studies of these defects are important in understanding the nature of stress in metals, the nature and behavior of doped crystals used in transistors, the production of perfect crystals and other phenomena. Microradiographic techniques are based on absorption, and the contrast in the images is because of the differences in absorption coefficients from point to point. X-ray diffraction tonography depends on image contrast upon point-to-point changes in the direction or the intensity of beams diffracted by planes in the crystal. There are various instrumental techniques where X-rays are employed for the analysis of sample. These are X-ray absorption, X-ray diffraction methods and X-ray fluorescence. These are dependent on interaction of the X-rays with the matter such as absorption, diffraction and fluorescence. These techniques are used in structure elucidation of crystals, annealing of metals, etc. With all this information, here we come to the end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. I'll be back with one more lecture in this series. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website www.cec.nic.in for multiple choice questions, quizzes, LORs, etc. Thank you for your time today. I will see you in the next lecture. Have a great day.